So in the previous video, I mentioned that it can be quite a challenge to install Prometheus and Grafana into a Kubernetes cluster. I've certainly spent many, many hours in the past tearing my hair out dealing with various problems installing it. I've discovered the easiest way to install Prometheus and Grafana is using a Kubernetes tool called Helm. So this is a really good chance to introduce you to Helm. Now, I don't use this tool very often. In fact, really, so far in my Kubernetes career, installing Prometheus and Grafana has been my only usage of Helm. So I'll warn you in advance, I'm by far a Helm expert, but I can certainly get you going. And also along the way, I'll talk about why I don't use Helm very often. It certainly has its place, but for me, it's not a day-to-day tool. But before I talk about that, I should explain what Helm is. And so I'm here on the Helm homepage, which at the time of recording is at helm.sh. And it's described here as a package manager for Kubernetes. Now, if you're used to using tools like Yum or apt-get or Brew on macOS or Chocolatey on Windows, then you'll immediately get a feel for what Helm is all about. Helm allows you to install an entire Kubernetes application using a single command line. Now, by Kubernetes application, they really mean a workload and services, a collection of pods, and a collection of services. So as a quick example off the top of my head, you might have been given the requirement to introduce a MySQL database into your Kubernetes cluster. Well, I would say there's a very good chance that there is a pre-packaged installation of MySQL, and you can install it using a single command line using this tool Helm. And after running that command line, you'll have a series of pods and services running, all pre-configured. So it sounds quite nice. And as I say, the reason that we're going to use it on the course is I think it's the easiest way to install Prometheus and Grafana. By the way, you might be wondering why I didn't use it to install the Elk stack previously. And the answer is, I'm sure it's possible to do that, but I have never had any success in doing so. So I prefer to do that manually by hand. I think Prometheus and Grafana is just a bit more complicated. And for this, I'm happy to let Helm do the lifting work. And the way that Helm works is we'll be installing a binary onto your, for us, it's that bootstrap instance that we're using just to issue commands. So the Helm binary just allows us to issue commands, but Helm will communicate with our Kubernetes cluster. And to do that, we will need a Helm pod running in the cluster as well. It's quite simple to set this up. You've got two options. If you're online and you're able to get to the helm.sh webpage, click through to Get Helm. That actually takes you to their GitHub repository. And going a little further down, we're looking for the link to install where binary downloads can be found. Now for us on the course, we're installing this onto our Amazon account, but as confirmed here, there are versions for macOS and Windows. So following the link to latest releases at the time of recording for me, 2.9.1. And again, just a little further down, I'm looking for Linux and I'm going to copy the link address. Now, if for any reason you're having problems finding this, I will include a script as part of this course. The only problem with that script is there will be a hard code in there of the version number of Helm. 2.9.1 at the time of recording, but you might want to upgrade that to a later version. On my AWS Bootstrap instance, I can do a wget on that link, which downloads a tar.gz file. And we can unpack that using tar, I think it's Z or Z, XVF, and then the file we've just downloaded. It's a really simple zip that it contains, apart from the README and the license, there's just a single binary file in there. And all we need to do is sudo mv, I'm going to move that file. So it's in the subfolder linux-amd64, and then the file is called Helm, and I'm going to move it into the /usr /local /bin directory. Okay, now we've done that, we can remove the helm.tar.gz file, and we can also do an rm-rf on the ./, I think the folder that unpacked was linux-amd64, just to tidy up. So the point of all that is you should now be able to type helm, and you should get the help page for helm. Furthermore, we can do a helm version, and you're probably going to find that that will hang. It's giving me the client version. It's hanging because it's trying to find the server version. I think it's using a kubectl in the background. It's trying to connect to a pod in our cluster. Now we need to install that pod, and this could not be easier. I'll control C that because it's clearly never going to complete. We just do helm init, and that's all there is to it. I'd forgotten this, the server-side component, the pod that it's installed is called tiller. If I do a kubectl get po on the, it will have installed that into the kube system namespace. You should now see a tiller pod. As usual, that might take a while to start up. Eventually, you should be able to do that helm version. And if you're getting a result back for the client and server, you've got Helm installed. So what kinds of things can we install with Helm? Well, back on the GitHub repository, I'm currently on the Helm repository under the Helm account. If I go up a level to the Helm account, you'll find in there a repository for charts. As described, this is a set of curated applications for Kubernetes. Under Incubator are a variety of projects that are currently being worked on. They're not considered stable, they're kind of in beta or beta. Whereas under Stable are the projects that you can consider safe to use in a production environment. And the only real thing I want to show you here is there is quite a lot of them. Now, I think for the purposes of this demo, we're going to go for what is often considered, I think, a Hello World application for Helm. And that is to very quickly install MySQL into our cluster. Now, we're not going to use MySQL, but it just serves as a useful starting point. So let's follow the link into MySQL. Now, there's usually a pretty good user guide for each of these Helm packages. It even gives you a quick start command to install the package. So as you can see here, we can just go ahead and do a helm install. I'll come back to what the name means in a minute, but the main argument is just the name of the package, stable/mysql. So that will go ahead and install a pod and a service. But I guess it's obvious that most of these packages are going to need some kind of configuration. In the case of MySQL, we're probably going to want something like an initial password for that database. So for that reason, you'll find for most of these packages, a configuration block which lists a long set of parameters that you can configure. They will all come with a default value. So let's go with the example of the initial password for MySQL. You can see here there is a parameter called MySQL. Notice MySQL, the S there is lowercase, but P is uppercase. And it is saying there is a default, but it is random 10 characters. Now it turns out that that random 10 characters isn't a problem, and I'll show you why in a minute. But for the purposes of the demo, I'm going to show you how you can override that and set your own password. Don't get disheartened. I think we are going to get an error when we run this command, but I'll explain why that's the case and I'll show you the fix. Before you install for the first time, I would recommend, in a very similar way to other package managers, you start with a Helm repo update. And that will just contact the remote repository and it will update all of our local indexes so that we're up to date with what's happening on the remote repository. So then we can do helm install, and it was stable/mysql. You'll have noticed on the example that they also specified a name with --name. Now what we can do whenever we install a piece of software with Helm is we can give that installation a name. And this is helpful because it means that a later date, if we decide we want to uninstall the installation, then we can do so by specifying this name. You'll also find that this name is used in all of the pods and the services that are created. So for the purposes of the demo, I'm going to use quite a long, clunky name, just so we can see it a bit further downstream. I'm going to go for my dash special dash installation. It can be anything you like. And the way that we override these configuration parameters is using the dash dash set argument, followed by the name of the parameter, which was MySQL password equals, and well, this database will not be accessible to the outside world, so I'm going to cheat and use password. That should be a valid Helm command. However, I think you'll probably find that you will get an error complaining that the default namespace is forbidden. Now, what's happening here is that the tiller pod, which remember is actually doing the work on the Kubernetes cluster, has been installed by default into the kubesystem namespace. And it turns out that that pod does not have the correct access privileges to allow it to start up new pods in the default namespace, which is what we want. Now, we haven't talked much about role-based authentication controls in Kubernetes. It's a relatively new feature. But the quick answer to this is that we need to set some access privileges so that that tiller pod is able to start up pods in the default namespace. I'm afraid that to fix this problem, you do need three quite complicated commands, and we're definitely not going to type those in longhand. So I've created a file called fixhelmprivileges.txt, which is attached to this video. So you have access to this file. Inspect it if you're interested. It's exactly what I've just described. It's adding a privilege to the tiller pod. You can simply just copy that and then paste that straight onto your command line. And as long as you have no errors here, you should now be able to recall the Helm install command. And hopefully now all has gone well. You'll find that when you install a package from Helm, you get a lot of output and it often looks like an error, but actually this is good. It's telling you exactly what it's done. It has created, in our case, a persistence volume claim, a config map, a secret, a service, a deployment, and a pod. So quite a complex structure that it's created there. And we can confirm with kubectl get po, for example. It's currently initializing a pod. Now notice that's why I used that long name. I just wanted to show you that whatever we called the Helm installation is prefixed to the pods. And you'll also find if you get the services in a similar way, it's created a service called myspecialinstallation-mysql. So when that pod's created, it's still initializing for me, but we're going to end up with a network service on port 3306 with the DNS name myspecialinstallation-mysql. So our other pods in the cluster could connect to that and work with it exactly as with a regular MySQL database. Let's just check with the getPO that, yeah, that is now running. Now, on these instructions, this is really helpful. They're giving you the three steps you can follow to very quickly verify that you really do have a running MySQL database. Now, I think by now you've probably got the point. If you really want to, you can go ahead and start up a Ubuntu pod. They're suggesting here you just do this as a kind of quick and dirty way of getting a pod up and running that you can bash into, and then you can install a MySQL client into that pod. And this is the crucial command. You're verifying here that you can connect to that database using myspecialinstallation-mysql as a host name. I'm guessing by now, though, you've got the point. I'll let you do that if you're interested. But for me, I'm going to end this very quick introduction to Helm by showing you can list all of your installations with Helm LS. And we can finally delete that installation with Helm delete my-special-installation. They make this quite awkward, but you to really get rid of the installation, you need to add in the command line argument --purge. Bit clunky that, but that will clean up that package and we can confirm with a getPO that, yeah, that pod is now terminating. So that was really a little bit of a digression. And just to close this talk on Helm, the reason I'm covering this on the course is really that I've just discovered it's the best way to get Prometheus and Grafana installed. However, in general, I don't use this when I'm managing a live cluster. And the reason is, let's go with the example we've just had. If we had the requirement to run MySQL on a cluster, I would probably build those pods myself. I would build the services myself in exactly the same way that I've done with the Mongo, and because I would consider that part of my application. So I would want that part of my code control system, and I would want full control over the YAML files. Of course, if you find yourself doing Helm installs on a running cluster, then you're basically setting up a Snowflake server. And you're going to have to remember how you built that server. So wherever possible, I'll just remind myself with an ls that I've got a collection of YAML files here which I can use to rebuild my cluster with a single command on any Kubernetes cluster that I like. So if I had the requirement to add MySQL to this, I'm probably going to build my own YAML file. And I'm prepared to make an exception for monitoring, because monitoring is kind of something that's not part of my application. It's something that I'm going to add to an already running cluster. So for that reason, in the next video, we're going to use Helm to install Prometheus and Grafana.